بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. All praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and peace be upon his beloved Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. I testify that there is no God except Allah, and I testify that Muhammad is the Prophet and the Messenger of Allah. Brothers and sisters, as you all might be aware, that tonight is the first night of this special series that we're going to begin. After a lot of demand and after a lot of people inquiring about us to redo this series, although we did it twice, alhamdulillah, and had a lot of and great response. So alhamdulillah, this is the third time that we initiate and we start with this death and a hereafter series. And inshallah, this series should go between 15 to 20 weeks. So we're aiming between 15 to 20 weeks. Depends how we go, inshallah, and how quick. And it's not about how quick, inshallah, it's about the information that we get and how we understand the information, and inshallah, how we implement the information in our lives. So inshallah, beginning with this new series every Thursday night here at the UMA Center after Salat al-Maghrib. And tonight is the first night and the first episode of this series, Death and the Hereafter. And my brothers and sisters, obviously when we talk about death and the hereafter, we're talking about different stages in life. We are talking about different stages in life. And the main stage that we're going to focus on is the stage that's after death. As there are four main stages in life. Okay? Or the human being goes through four main stages. The first stage is the stage that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created your soul. The first stage is the stage that Allah created your soul, which is the stage before this life. And that stage is called Alam al-Arwah, the life or the world of souls. The world of souls. Then we come to the second stage and the second world that we live in right now, which is the world of life, the world of dunya. Then you come to a third stage, which is after death and before the hereafter, is called Alam al-Barzakh, the world of Barzakh. And then you come to the fourth and final stage, which is Alam Yawm al-Qiyamah, the world of Day of Judgment. And obviously, I'm going to explain one by one. Keep in mind, my brothers and sisters, that in this series, inshallah, we only depend on the authentic sources of the Quran and Sunnah. As this is a topic, we are talking about the unseen world. We're not talking about a world that we see, a world that we've experienced. We're talking about a world that we haven't experienced. We're talking about a world that we have not experienced, nor that someone had experienced that world and came and told us about it. So the knowledge that we have on the unseen world and a world that we have no experience in is only based on what Allah and His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had told us. And obviously, no one has better knowledge than Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had passed on to His Messenger Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And because it's an unseen world, a world that we have not experienced and a world that no one had experienced that world and came back and told us about, you find that the knowledge of it is limited. The knowledge of it is limited. And not only that, because it's an unseen world, and a world that there's no experience in, and a world that you never experience unless you die, but if you die you can't come back into this world. So it's a very restricted knowledge. It's not something that you could give your opinion. It's not that a sheikh or an imam can sit down and say, well, I think in hereafter this will happen or that will happen. Well, based on what? What do you know about that world? You haven't experienced it. Nor that you've experienced someone that experienced it. So our knowledge to that is very restricted. And it's a knowledge that a personal reasoning or a personal opinion cannot come in, because it's not something that you have experienced. And it's not something that you had heard from someone who had experienced it. And that's why we only restrict ourselves to the Quran and Sunnah. But keep in mind, what you hear and what you're going to know, okay, is very, very little in comparison to what is really out there. Okay? And no one knows the reality of that except Allah Azza wa Jal. And then no one knows of what's really happening except those who are experiencing it right now or those who will experience it later on. That's why we restrict ourselves to the Quran and the Sunnah and the authentic sources that came through this information, and this is what we restrict ourselves to. Now obviously everyone loves to know more, and by the nature of mankind, people get interested to unseen knowledge. We get interested in that knowledge, you know? That's why people get fascinated in magic shows. People love nature, although it's prohibited for us to see those shows, but by nature of mankind, people love to see those things. Why? Because it's something different, it's unseen. People get attracted to that. And even amongst Muslims, they get attracted to that information, they get attracted to that knowledge, the knowledge of the unseen, the knowledge of the hereafter. But where the problem is, you find a problem in how people deal with that knowledge. How Muslims deal with that knowledge. You find some Muslims that their whole life revolves around that knowledge. About death, about the Mahdi, about the signs of the Day of Judgment. Oh, did the signs of the Day of Judgment come? Are they close? How far is it? And you find their whole life revolves to it. That some said, you know what, what's the point of us striving in life and we'll wait for the Khalifa or Mahdi to come. You know, you become so despondent in life, you become so despair that, you know, why should I strive for, wait for the Mahdi to come? And this is obviously a bab, a door or a gate of the shaitan, that shaitan comes and plays around on people. Well, my brothers and sisters, this knowledge is for us to know, to increase our iman, to increase our iman, and to understand what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem, what His Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had narrated to us. And with that, inshallah, we increase our iman and we increase our faith in Allah, increase our iman and taqwa with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and at the same time increase from our actions, our a'mal. And this is the main primary purpose. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us. Allah azza wa jalla trials us with the unseen information, with the unseen world. And the first one who is unseen is Allah. Allah is unseen. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is unseen. And Allah Azza wa Jalla can show Himself to us. But then if Allah shows Himself to us, what's the point of tests? It's like, for example, if the teacher gives you the answers to the exam, then what's the point of the exam? If the teacher gives you the answers to the exam, this is no point to be examined. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala shows us all the unseen and shows us Himself, then what's the point of tests? There's no longer trials. Everyone will be good. You can't compare between good and bad because everyone's good. Everyone's seen Allah and everyone is obedient to Allah. And then everyone's going to the Jannah. There's no longer such thing called hellfire because everyone becomes at one level. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wants to see those who believe in Allah azza wa jal by just reading what was revealed to His messengers, and those who deny what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned. And that's why this is, of course, it's called the unseen world. The unseen world, a world that we have not seen, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tests us to see our iman, our faith into the unseen world based on what Allah tells us. I'll repeat that again, okay? Allah tests us, and Allah will judge us over our iman and faith, over what we believe in the unseen world based on what Allah tells us. So you believe in death, and you believe in the punishment of death, and you believe in the paradise and the hellfire, and you believe in the Day of Judgment. Well, have you seen the Day of Judgment? Have you seen the hellfire? Have you seen the paradise? You haven't seen that. Why do you believe in it? You say, because Allah told me. So on that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will test you. Others will say, I don't believe in it. But didn't Allah tell you? Well, I don't believe in what Allah said. Well, this is the big test. And this is where people are falling and failing in. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He mentions that in the Quran al-Kareem, Alif Lam Mim, ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين الذين يؤمنون بالغيب ويقيمون الصلاة ومما رزقناهم ينفقون ألف لامين ذلك الكتاب لا ريب فيه هدى للمتقين. This is the book that there's no doubt in it. There's no doubtful matters in it. هدى, guidance for those who are fearful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الذين يؤمنون بالغيب. Then Allah describes those who fear Allah, those who believe in the unseen. What's the unseen? Allah is the unseen. The angels are the unseen. Day of Judgment is the unseen. Hellfire and paradise is the unseen. Allah tests you through you believing in that. But you haven't seen it. But I believe in it. And I believe in it to the stage that I've seen it. This is what Umar ibn Khattab said, by Allah, if Allah opens the heavens right now and lets me see the hellfire with my own eyes and the paradise with my own eyes, that would not even increase my faith. Why? Because his faith is already up there without even seeing it. That's it. Allah told him it's there. The iman is there. It reached to there. Why? Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had told us. And we know that The main fundamentals of the Iman, what are the main principles of Iman, the six pillars of Iman? هو أن تؤمن بالله, to believe in Allah, وملائكته and his angels, وكتبه and the sacred books, ورسله and prophets and messengers. Okay, واليوم الآخر, the day of judgment, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also mentions in the Quran Kareem many verses, والقدر خيره وشره, the divine destiny is good and bad both from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah azza wa jalla is unseen, angels are unseen, sacred books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, we see the Quran Kareem, but the Torah and the Injil and the Zabur, the true ones or the authentic ones, we haven't seen them. Prophets and messengers, all of them we haven't seen. Some yes, some human beings were pleasured and honored to see the prophets and messengers, including the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, but us, we haven't seen any of them. But yet we believe in Muhammad. Has anyone seen Muhammad? We believe in Adam. Has anyone seen Adam? We believe in Nuh and Ibrahim, but has anyone seen Nuh and Ibrahim? We believe in all the prophets and messengers that Allah had mentioned, but has anyone seen them? So they're unseen to us. We haven't seen them. And then Allah Azza wa Jal commands us to believe in the day of judgment. Has anyone seen the day of judgment? Has anyone experienced the day of judgment? And yet we believe in that. So it is part of our Iman. It is part of our faith. It is a fundamental pillar of Islam and Iman that we believe into the unseen, and that includes the subject that we'll be talking about, which is death and the hereafter. Which most of the things that we talk about, most of the things that relate to death and the hereafter are the unseen. Unseen world, alam al-ghayb. Now obviously, this is a challenge that the prophets and the messengers challenged their own people, including the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They challenged him, and they challenged him over the matters of the hereafter, over the matters of death. And these are one of the major things they used to make mockery of the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. And they used to say to him, okay, وَلَيْنَ أَطَعْتُمْ بَشَرًا مِثْلَكُمْ إِنَّكُمْ إِذَا لَخَاسِرُونَ أَيَعِدُكُمْ أَنَّكُمْ إِذَا مِتُّمْ وَكُنْتُمْ تُرَابًا وَعِظَامًا إِنَّكُمْ مَخْرَجُونَ هَيْهَاتَ هَيْهَاتَ لِمَا تُوَعَدُونَ إِنْ هِيَ إِلَّا حَيَاتُنَا الدُّنْيَا نَمُوتُ وَنَحْيَا وَمَا نَحْنُ بِمَبْعُوثِينَ. They used to say, this man claims they will bring you back life after your death. What's this man talking about? You know, they used to find it very hard to believe. After we die and we turn into dust, your Lord is going to bring us back alive. And then they used to say, what's this man talking about? It's only this life that we live in. We will live in it and die. And there's no death. There's no life after death. There's no such thing that these crazy people are coming with. And even reached to the stage that a man came to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam, grabbed a handful of dust and he let it go. And he said, oh Muhammad, you claim that your Lord will bring us back alive after we die and we become, our bones become like this dust, our bones turn to dust like this. You claim that your Lord will bring us back alive after we die? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied back to them in a very logical way. Very logical, very straightforward and profound way. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, أَوَلَمْ يَرَى الْإِنسَانِ أَنَّا خَلَقْنَاهُ مِنْ نُطْفَةٍ فَإِذَا وَخَصِيمٌ مُبِينٌ وَضَرَبَ لَنَا مَثَلًا وَنَسِيَ خَلْقَهُ قَالَ مَنْ يُحْيِي الْعِظَامَ وَهِيَ رَمِيمٌ. Didn't this human being see that we had created him from a simen? And then he comes to us and gives us an example, challenging us that how could your Lord bring the dead back alive? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replies back, قُلْ يُحْيِيهَا الَّذِي أَنْشَأَ وَالْمَرَّةِ. Say to them, O Muhammad, the one that created you the first time will bring you the second time. That should not be your worry, how Allah Azza wa Jal will bring you back alive after your death. Your major question should be, how did you come from the first place? That's the most confusing part. If you think it's confusing for you and it's unbelievable for you to believe that God can bring you back alive after your death, then how did you come from the first time? Who got you the first time? So the one that got you the first time can bring you the second time and third time and fourth time. And the one that got you the first time and did not make a mistake in it, Allah can bring you the second time and third time and the fourth time. And the one that got you the first time out of nothing can bring you this time out of something. So this is the mentality that the people of the kufr had and those who had challenges towards the prophets and the messengers. And many verses including where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا أقسم بيوم القيامة ولا أقسم بالنفس اللوامة أيحسب الإنسان أن لن نجمع عظامه بلى قادرين على أن نسوي بنانا. What a beautiful words. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala makes a promise. Allah azza wa jal, he swore by the day of judgment. Allah swore by the day of judgment. You don't believe in the day of judgment? Well, Allah is going to make an oath and Allah Azza wa Jalla swore by the day of judgment. What did Allah swore by the day? Is Allah going to make an oath? Is Allah going to make a promise by something that does not exist? Would you make a promise by something that does not exist? Obviously, you make a promise by something that you value. Well, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He made a promise by the day of judgment. So if you deny the day of judgment, well, Allah Azza wa Jalla saying, لا أقسم بيوم القيامة. I will make an oath and I'll make a swore by the day of judgment. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla, He says, أَيَحْسَبُ الْإِنسَانُ أَلَّا نَجْمَعَ عِظَامَ. Does the human being think we cannot resemble, we cannot bring his bones together again after his death? Does this human being think that after his death we can't bring him back alive? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, Bala, indeed, yes. And then Allah Azza wa Jalla says, Qadirina ala an nusawwiya banana. Not only we could bring him back the way he was, we could even bring his fingers and the fingerprints that he had during his life after his death. And we know there's no human being, there's no two human beings on the surface of this earth, including twins, can match one fingerprint. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says we could not only bring him back alive, but we'll bring back even his fingerprints the way they were before his death. This is the greatness of Allah. That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that brings life and the one that brings death. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, الذي يحيي ويميت, He is the one that gives life and He is the one that grants death. But He is the Hay, He is the one that's alive and never dies. It is the nature of the creation of Allah that they have one thing in common with Allah. They live and Allah is alive. But the difference is they die and Allah never dies. Allah lives forever and the human being doesn't live forever, because this is the nature of the creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why, my brothers and sisters, it is important that we believe in what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam had told us from what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had revealed to him. And denying anything in the Quran al-Kareem or any major authentic source of the Quran, of the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that's reached to the level of tawatur, that could lead someone to kufr, which means being out of the fold of Islam. Being out of the fold of Islam. So if I deny, if someone says, look, I pray and I fast, but I don't believe in such thing called Day of Judgment, this is kufr. Why? Because you are denying something that Allah had mentioned. Someone says, I pray and fast and I do qiyam and I pay zakat, but I don't believe in something called hellfire, this is kufr. Because Allah told us there's something called hellfire. He cannot deny something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned. No. Also, my brothers and sisters, what we want to come out of this, not only to motivate ourselves and to have the iman, but we also want to understand something, to understand the purpose of our existence. To understand the purpose of our existence. Why do I exist? Is there a purpose for my life? Is there a purpose for my existence? And you know that question, alhamdulillah, maybe because we were born as Muslims, we have an answer to it. But there are some people out there that are killing themselves to find the answer. They are committing suicide just to find the answer. What's the purpose of the existence? Well, obviously to us it's answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that existed us and the one that created us. Where He says subhanahu wa ta'ala, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I only created the jinn, which is the spirits, and the ins, for the sake of my worship. مَا أُرِيدُ مِنْهُمْ رِزْقٍ وَمَا أُرِيدُ أَنْ يُطْعِمُونَ. I don't want them to sustain me, nor that I want them to feed anyone. إِنَّ اللَّهُ وَالرَّزَّاقُ ذُو الْقُوَّةِ الْمَتِينَ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that sustains. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the most powerful, almighty. So we have a purpose. We have a purpose of our existence. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala did not create us foolishly. You as a human being, you did not create something for the sake of it. When you create something, or when you make up something, or when you manufacture something, you do it because you find there is a purpose that made you resort to make this thing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is greater than us, and Allah azza wa jal does not, or He did not create this whole world for the sake of foolishness. He did not create this whole world for the sake of nothing. There is a purpose. And Allah says in the Quran al-Kareem, أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا وَأَنَّكُمْ إِلَيْنَا لَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Do you think that we created you foolishly and you're not coming back or returning back to us? You think your creation was just created just like that? You know, just like a game we've got extra time we want to waste, like that human being thinks. We created you foolishly and you think you're not coming back to us? أَفَحَسِبْتُمْ أَنَّمَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ عَبَثًا. You think we created you foolish and you're not coming back to us? فتعالى الله. Allah is above that. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is greater than that. You would not even accept that to be on a human being, where a human being will create something big for nothing. Allah is greater than that. Allah did not create this human being for no purpose, or no purpose of his existence, or no purpose of life. فتعالى الله الملك الحق لا إله إلا هو هو رب العرش الكريم. سبحانه وتعالى, glory be to him. Yes, Allah created us for a purpose, and the purpose is to believe in him, obey him, and then when we die we face him subhanahu wa ta'ala, we face him in the hereafter to be judged and either hellfire or the paradise. And this is one of the other reasons that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the punishment of death, and he created death itself, and he created the punishment of the hereafter, and he created the hereafter itself for the reason of his justice. This is the justice of Allah. Can you imagine that in this world you have the good and bad, you have the righteous and the wicked, and then the righteous and the good person does whatever pleases Allah, and the bad or the wicked does whatever he pleases, whatever he pleases himself, or whatever the shaitan is pleased. And then at the end of the day, both the good and bad, the righteous and the wicked, will end up in one hole? That's not justice. Where's the justice of that? Where is the fairness here? That's why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, from his justice, from his fairness subhanahu wa ta'ala, he created death, where the one who did good and he forbid himself from falling into a lot of, from falling into a lot of desires, Allah will give him the pleasure in the hereafter. But with the one who done bad and the wicked one who followed his desires and followed the path of the shaitan, well, you got what you wanted in this world, but you're not going to get what you want in the hereafter. So this is from the justice of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So my brothers and sisters, I do encourage that inshallah from this, not just to be fascinated by the information that we get, but inshallah we want to increase our iman with it. We want to increase our iman with it. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam encouraged us, and this is inshallah reviving the sunnah of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he said, أَكْثِرُوا مِن ذِكْرِ هَذِي مِن لَذَّاتِ. Constantly increase from the remembrance of the destroyer of desires. The said, or messenger of Allah, and what is the destroyer of desires, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said? Death. Death. Yes, death. When you constantly remind yourself about death, and what's after death, it destroys your desires. You're no longer interested in what's after death and what's before death. You become more interested in what's after death. That's why the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam describes death as hadhim al-ladhat, the destroyer of desires. You become more interested in what's after death than what's before death. You're no longer interested in your desires, but you become more interested in pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and more interested in what you really created for, which is the pleasure of Allah azza wa jal. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mana hadith where he says, take advantage of five before five, and take advantage of your life before death. Take advantage of your life before death. Take advantage of this moment that you live and you breathe air, and the moment that you could act and do a lot before you die and you cannot do anything. And also, as he sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, that when the dead is taken to the graveyard to be buried, three things will follow him. And then he says sallallahu alayhi wasallam, his family and wealth and his deeds will follow him to the graveyard. But once he is buried, his family and wealth will go back, but his deeds will stay with him. Yes, only the deeds. My brothers and sisters, it is only your deeds, what you've done in this world, that will follow you in that time. At that time when you become so lonely and nothing around you except yourself and your deeds and what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prepared for you. So inshallah, we want to not only to increase our knowledge of this, and not just to be fascinated by the information that we hear, and not only to know about the greatness of Allah through his creation, but we also want also inshallah through this to increase our iman and increase our deeds, to know that there is a lot for us to prepare, to know that we need to do a lot more. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, "An-nasu niyam fa idha matun tabahu." People are asleep. People are asleep, but when they die, they wake up. People are asleep. When they die, they wake up. People are asleep. They are asleep from obeying Allah Azza wa Jal. They are asleep from following the path of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. They are asleep from following the Quran and Sunnah. But when they die, that's when they wake up and realize on what they've missed out on and what they've forgotten. But unfortunately, that time they wake up after death, it's a wake up that you can't come back into this dunya. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions that in the Quran al-Kareem, as will hear many of those ahadith. So brothers and sisters, we go back to saying that this world that we live in is the second stage in which the scholars refer to it, عالم الدنيا, the world of dunya, the world of dunya. Before this world, they used to be called عالم الأرواح, the world of souls. After this world, it will be the world of barzakh, and after the world of barzakh, it will be the world of the hereafter. It all revolves around one thing that's moving throughout those four worlds. There's one thing in you that's moving throughout those four worlds. It is called the soul. It is called the soul. So the main aspect of you is the soul. This body is not the major thing. The major thing is your soul. So your soul existed before this body. And your soul will exist after this body dies. So it is your soul, the main aspect, the main part of you that's moving out from the beginning, that's moving throughout this world. And what is the soul? The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked that question. And he says, alayhi salatu wa salam, when he asked that question, he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, so Allah azza wa jalla revealed in the Quran al-Kareem, يسألونك عن الروح قل الروح من أمر ربي وما أوتيت من العلم إلا قليلا. Oh Muhammad, they ask you about the soul. These are one of the questions that the Jews gave to the Arab to ask Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to know if he's truly a prophet or a prophet and a messenger or not. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked that question, and alayhi salatu wa salam then asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, waiting for the answer to come back. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala replied back to the Prophet alayhi salatu wa salam in Surah Al-Isra, oh Muhammad, they ask you about the soul. They ask you about the ruh. Tell them that the soul is from the knowledge of Allah. Tell them the soul is a knowledge that Allah kept for himself. There's a lot of knowledge out there. Some of that knowledge Allah gave it to us. And what Allah had given us is a lot smaller than what Allah had kept. What Allah had given us is a lot smaller than what Allah had kept for himself. To the stage that when Musa was with Al-Khidr, when he was on the boat, and a little bird came and stood on the edge of that boat and drank from the water of the sea, Al-Khidr told Musa, oh Musa, your knowledge compared to my knowledge is that dot that this bird had drank from the sea. And my knowledge to compare to the knowledge of Allah is that dot that that bird had drank from the sea. So the knowledge that we have and everything that we have around us, as much as that we see it very big to be, it is very little compared to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows and compared to what Allah azza wa jalla had kept. And one of those knowledges that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had kept to himself is the knowledge of the soul, al-ruh. Although some scholars had spoken about it, but not in deep. But as much as they speak about it, still, it is something that we don't know much of. But there's one thing that we know of. It does exist. Well, I've got a soul. If my soul was not in this body, then this body would not function. And if that soul of yours is not in that body, you would not be here. Or you would not listen. So there is something called soul. But when did that soul exist? Did this soul exist now or did it exist before? This soul existed in a world before this world. This world before this world called عالم الأرواح. عالم الأرواح. The world of souls. Where does that come from? When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created Adam alayhi salam, the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, Allah wiped with his right. Allah wiped with his right. What right? Allahu alam. Wiped with his right the back of Adam. There Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Adam see all his descendants to the day of judgment, including me and you. Remember that time? You can't remember? I can't remember either. Okay? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made Adam see all his children, all his descendants to the day of judgment, including me and including you. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as he says in the Quran al-Kareem, وَإِذْ أَخَذَ رَبُّكَ مِنْ بَنِي آدَمَ مِنْ ظُهُورِهِمْ ذُرِّيَّتَهُمْ وَأَشْهَدَهُمْ عَلَى أَنفُسِهِمْ أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. When Allah Azza wa Jalla says in Surah Al-A'raf, when your Lord had taken a firm word, a pledge, a word, affirmation from the children of Adam, which is many and everyone that existed from Adam to the day of judgment, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told them, أَلَسْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ. Aren't I your Lord?
Do you see me as your Lord? So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قَالُوا بَلَى Yes, O Allah, شَهِدْنَا أَن تَقُولُ يَوْمَ الْقِيَامَةِ إِنَّا كُنَّا عَنْ هَذَا غَفِرُ Oh Allah, we witness. We do witness that you are our Lord. Every single human being witness to Allah that He is the Lord of the universe. He is the Lord of this world. He is the Lord of the hereafter. He is the creator. He is the sustainer. And every single human being from the time of Adam to the day of judgment witnessed that when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala made them all appear in front of Adam. Even Adam saw. He even saw different people, and he saw a man with a brightness, and he saw that was Dawood alayhi salam, and he saw Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and he saw, and he saw, and he saw, and he probably saw me and you, but we existed then. But then you ask yourself, why can't I remember? Why can't I remember that time? Well, you cannot remember that time because what you remember with did not exist. What do you remember with? You remember with a brain. You remember with something called an intellect. Your brain and intellect did not exist until he came into this second world. So the first world was Alam al-Arwah, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the souls. And the souls were there. In which world, which part of the world? Allahu Alam. Then that soul will move from that world into this world, which is Alam al-Dunya, where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala creates a body for this soul to fit in. And that's where you come into your physical body and attached to this physical body. Then you start using your brains and your intellect, and then you say, you know what, I can't remember. You can't remember anything before that brain started to work. That brain did not exist until it came into this dunya. And you live in this world, which is a world of trials, a world of tests, dar bala. It's not dar. It is not the world of happiness, or the world of luxury, or the world where I could do whatever I want. It is the world of test. You are restricted to the guidelines of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in this world. And you are tested by Allah azza wa jal for everything you do in this world. At the end of the day, you get paid in accordance to what you do in this world when you move on to the third world, which is Alam al-Barzakh. And Alam al-Barzakh, and the word Barzakh in Arabic means barrier. The word barzakh in Arabic means barrier. Okay? The reason that it's called Alam al-Barzakh, it's because it's a world between this world and the world of the hereafter. So it's a barrier in between. Which is that world that comes after your death and before your resurrection of the hereafter. Okay? So after this dunya, after this world, which is the world of dunya, you will pass away. When you die, you will get in a different world called Alam al-Barzakh. This world is a world between the world of the dunya and the world before the day of resurrection. So you are in a world of the dead people, as they say. That you are in a world of the dead people. And this is, inshallah, what we'll talk about in depth about the world of the dead people. What happens in that world, Alam al-Barzakh? So I want you to differentiate between Alam al-Barzakh and Alam Yawm Al-Qiyamah. Alam Al-Barzakh is that world between this dunya and the hereafter. And then the hereafter is a different world. The hereafter is a different world. So after death, you do not go to the hereafter. Even though there's a lot of narrations that say and narrate that there are some people in the paradise, a lot of scholars say that that's later on. Whenever the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam spoke about people being in the paradise, it's not about current, it's about later. Okay? Although it's a controversial topic amongst the scholars, are there any people in the paradise right now? Or is it only people enter the paradise and the hellfire only after the day of resurrection? That's something the scholars had spoken about. And majority of them say it's all after the day of resurrection. The gates of the paradise, the gates of the hellfire do not open to anyone only after the day or after the world of resurrection, of the world of day of judgment. Before that, it's the world of Barzakh, which is the world where people die. But that world, there is punishment. And that's why it's been narrated that the grave, it's either a hole of the paradise or a hole of the hellfire. And that's where people wait until Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala resurrects them for the day of resurrection. And the day of resurrection is in a different world than the world we're in now. On a different earth that we are on. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the Quran al-Kareem, the day that we will exchange and replace this world with a different world and a different heavens. But that's something inshallah we'll talk about. In this series inshallah, we'll talk about death. And we'll talk about signs of the death. And then inshallah we'll talk about what happens after death. We'll talk about alam al-barzakh, what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam had told us about that. Then we'll move on to something that's relating this world but a preparation for the hereafter, which we'll talk about the major signs and the minor signs. And we'll start with the minor signs before the major signs of the Day of Judgment, which tells us indications from the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam when and how close is the Day of Judgment. But at the end of the day, brothers and sisters, this is all for us to increase our iman and to do more. All that is for us to increase our iman and to do more. And obviously, when we speak about death, we are talking about reality here. We are talking about reality. A reality that no one can run away from. Now, even though that we believe in death, and even though that if you ask anyone, you believe in death, they'll say yes. But there is a problem. We do not understand the reality of death. We do not understand the reality of death. Because if we understood the reality of death, we would not do a lot of the things that we do. If we understood the reality of death, there's a lot of things that we're supposed to not be doing, we'll stop doing them. But because we lack that reality of it, we do what we should not be doing. We fall into a lot of things that we should not be falling into. And that's why, let us understand as much as we can understand from the reality of this truth that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He says in the Quran al-Kareem to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّكَ مَيِّتٌ وَإِنَّهُمْ مَيِّتُونَ. Oh Muhammad, you will be dying and everyone else will be dying. If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala wanted to keep death away from anyone, he would have kept it away from his beloved human being and his beloved creation Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And yet Allah made it clear to Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that you shall taste death and everyone else shall taste death. Everyone, every single creation of Allah will taste death. The only one that does not die is except Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah azza wa jal is the one that lives and never dies. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the one that grants death and life, and He is the one that lives and never dies. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says to Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, من أحب لقاء الله أحب الله لقاءه ومن كره لقاء الله كره الله لقاءه. Whoever loves to meet Allah, Allah loves to meet them. And whoever dislikes to meet Allah, Allah dislikes to meet them. So Aisha responded back and she replied and she said, O Messenger of Allah, are you referring to death? The truth is, every single human being hates death. If that's what you're talking about, well let's accept the fact that every human being hates death. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he replied back to Aisha and he said, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said that, O Aisha, when the righteous servant of Allah who done good in this life and pleased Allah, he knows what Allah had prepared for him. Allah had prepared His mercy for him. Allah Azza wa Jalla had prepared His paradise for him. Allah had prepared Allah for him. And therefore, he looks forward to what Allah had prepared for him. And in return, Allah looks forward to meeting him. But the disbeliever or the disobedient, he knows what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prepared for him from his anger. He knows what Allah Azza wa Jalla had prepared for him from his punishment and the hellfire. And therefore, he does not look forward to meeting Allah. And Allah Azza wa Jalla does not look forward to meeting him. And that's something I need to always ask myself. Am I amongst those who is looking forward to meet Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Am I amongst those who is looking forward to stand before Allah azza wa jal? Am I from amongst those who Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is looking forward to meeting me? Because my brothers and sisters, hating death is a sign of hypocrisy. Hating death is a sign of hypocrisy. Because as a believer, I look forward to death. Why? Because I look forward to what Allah had prepared for me. I look forward to the rahmah of Allah. I look forward to the jannah of Allah. I look forward to the glory that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is preparing for me, the honor that Allah azza wa jalla had prepared for me. But the hypocrite, the disobedient, doesn't look forward to that because he knows what Allah azza wa jalla had prepared for him. He's so attached to this world, does not want to let go of it. And that's why Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he mentions one of the great diseases that this ummah will be affected with, that this ummah would lose its glory, this ummah would lose its respect and honor in front of its enemies. He said, al-wahan. So sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was asked, O Messenger of Allah, what is the wahan? He said, alayhi salatu wa sallam, the love of this world and the hatred of death. The hatred of death. Not that we're talking about look forward to die. That's not recommended that I want to die. But look forward to what Allah had prepared for you after death. Look forward to what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had prepared for you after death. And that's why Abdullah ibn Mas'ud, what did he used to say? Or Abdullah ibn Umar radiallahu ta'ala an, he said, if you wake up in the morning, don't wait for the night. And if you are not, don't wait for the morning. And take from your life what you need. In other words, I live my life as if I'm going to live forever. But also I live my life as if I'm going to die tomorrow. Be balanced in between. I do what I need to do as a living human being. At the same time, I also remember that death is near at any moment. Death can come at any moment. Death will take me at any moment. Something that I can't run away from. And something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had mentioned in the Quran al-Kareem. وَمَا جَعَلْنَا لِبَشَرٍ مِّن قَبْلِكَ الْخُلْدِ أَفَإِن مِتَّ فَهُمُ الْخَالِدُونَ كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ وَنَبْلُوكُمْ بِالشَّرِّ وَالْخَيْرِ فِتْنَةً وَإِلَيْنَا تُرْجَعُونَ. Oh Muhammad, we had never ever made anyone before you to live forever. If you die, it does not mean that we'll live forever. And then Allah says, كُلُّ نَفْسٍ ذَائِقَةُ الْمَوْتِ. Every soul must taste death. Every soul must taste death. No one can run away from. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he says, فَأَيْنَ تَذْهَبُونَ. Where are you going to run? You can't run away. You could run away from everyone except Allah. And you could run away from everything except death. You can't run away from death. And that's why it's my duty and your duty as a Muslim to constantly remind ourselves about this moment, about that reality in which every single one of us will face. And every single one of us will stand before. And every single one of us will experience. And every single one of us will be tested, because the greatest test is death. The last and the final test is death. And that's why we should always prepare for that. And one of the good signs of death, one of the good signs of death is that you die on La ilaha illallah. One of the great signs of death is that you die on that great word, the kalima of tawheed, which is La ilaha illallah. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, whoever was his last words, La ilaha illallah, will enter the Jannah. Whoever dies on that word, and it's his final word, he will enter the Jannah. And the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he told Mu'adh, he said, oh Mu'adh, listen. And Mu'adh said, oh Messenger of Allah, I'm listening. And then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, oh Mu'adh, listen. And he said, oh Messenger of Allah, I'm listening. And then the third time the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told him, oh Mu'adh, listen. He said, oh Messenger of Allah, I'm listening. So the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, من كان آخر كلامه لا إله إلا الله دخل الجنة. Whoever the final word where لا إله إلا الله enter the Jannah. So Mu'adh said, Allahu Akbar, oh Messenger of Allah, shouldn't I tell people so people get happy? So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, no, people are not going to get happy. People are just going to rely on this. If people know of this, then they'll think it's enough for them just to say La ilaha illallah before the death. That's what the Prophet ﷺ meant. Idhan yattakilu, then they'll just rely on this hadith and forget everything else they must do in Islam. But when Mu'adh radiallahu ta'ala anhu, he kept that secret with him. He kept it with him radiallahu ta'ala anhu until his death. Before his death, he said radiallahu ta'ala anhu to those around him, he said, I remember the Prophet ﷺ saying this hadith to me, and the only reason I'm saying it is just the trust of carrying the amanah of the knowledge. He kept it with him until he faced the last moment of his life and he informed the people around him, just the fear that people then rely on that hadith. And that's how you find typical Muslims. They say, are we going to enter the Jannah at the end of the day? Then let me do whatever I want to do.
Exactly what the Prophet ﷺ said, it's exactly what's happening. People rely on that hadith and think that there's no need to pray, there's no need to fast, there's no need to strive, there's no need to sacrifice, there's no need to keep away from the haram, because at the end of the day, I'll say la ilaha illallah and enter the Jannah. That's what the Prophet ﷺ said, then people will just rely on it. People will just rely on it. But one of the great signs of a good ending, my brothers and sisters, is that you end with la ilaha illallah. That's why the sunnah, when someone is on his deathbed, which is the stages that you see someone dying, that's it. He's going and he's not coming. It is sunnah that we make talqeen, which is stand around the dead while his soul is taking, or his soul is taking, and you say, it's taken, and it's been taken by the angels. You say, La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. La ilaha illallah Muhammadur Rasulullah. And make sure that he dies on it. Make sure that this dead dies on it. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who die on it. Also, one of the good signs of a good death, of a righteous death, a death of a good believer, is that when someone is dying, they are sweating. So sweating is not a bad sign. But the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, it's been narrated by Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, she said that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he died in my lap. And alayhi salatu wasalam was sweating. And he sallallahu alayhi wasalam had a cup of water. And every time sallallahu alayhi wasalam would put his hands in that cup of water, wipe his forehead and say, Inna lil mawti sakarat. Allah, death, the agony of death is harsh. The agony of death is harsh. And this is Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasalam. Muhammad alayhi salatu wasalam, the greatest human being sallallahu alayhi wasalam, was going through the harshness of death. And he is the messenger of Allah. And he'll wipe sallallahu alayhi wa sallam his forehead and continue to say, La ilaha illallah, inna lil mawti sakarat. Death has a harsh agony. Death is hard. This death is harsh. The last stages of death is harsh. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And also one of the good signs of death is someone dying on the day of Friday. Someone dying on Friday is one of the good signs of death. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, any Muslim that dies on the day of Friday or the night of Friday, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prevent him from the punishment of death. Any Muslim who dies on Friday evening, which is starting from Thursday Maghrib till Fajr, or Friday day, which is starting from Fajr on Friday till Maghrib. Okay, this is how the day and night begin. The night first, then the day. Anyone that dies on Friday evening, or anyone that dies on Friday the day, during the day, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will prevent them from the punishment of the grave. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prevent us from the punishment of the grave. Also, my brothers and sisters, we should always have good thoughts in Allah. Especially when someone is dying, you should have good thoughts in Allah. That even though they've committed a lot of sins, even though that you've done a lot of wrong things, even though that you know yourself, you've done bad in your life, but during that moment that you know you're only going one way, you're not coming back, have good thoughts of your Lord. Because Allah is always greater than what you think. Allah is greater than what you think. Have good thoughts in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that even though that I've done wrong, but ya Allah, what's my mistake in comparison to your mercy? What have I done in my life? What's that comparing to your mercy, Ya Arhamar Rahimin? You are the most merciful. You are the one that said about yourself that your mercy defeats your anger. You are the one that said about yourself, Wa rahmati wasi'at kulla shay, that my mercy fits everything. You, Allah, you're the one that said that. I didn't say it. You said that. So what's my sins in comparison to your mercy? Your mercy is above that, Ya Arhamar Rahimin. Your mercy is greater than that. This is the Muslim should have good thoughts in Allah. Have good thoughts in Rabbil Alameen. Have good thoughts in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That even though I've done wrong in my life, even though I've disobeyed Allah, now I'm going to stand in front of Him. But my Lord is greater than what I think. Yes, Allah punishes severely. Yes, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has a severe punishment. But His mercy is always greater. And Allah will forgive. So have good thoughts in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have good hope. Have high hopes in Allah Azza wa Jal, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will forgive you, even though that you've fallen into a lot of things, even though that you've committed a lot of things. But have hopes in Allah Azza wa Jal, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith al-Qudsi, I am in accordance to the way of my servant thinks of me. Ana 'inda dhanni 'abdi bi. So your thought of Allah is what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is.
In other words, your hopes in Allah is what you get. Your hopes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is what you get. So have high hopes in Allah. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ لَا تَقْنَطُوا مِنْ رَحْمَةِ اللَّهِ إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Allah is calling upon the disobedient servants, those who have been disobeying Him, those who have been neglecting Him, those who have been committing the sins. Allah is calling upon those. And He is saying, say to the servants, do not break your hopes from my mercy. Don't have despair from my mercy. إِنَّ اللَّهَ يَغْفِرُ الذُّنُوبَ جَمِيعًا. Allah forgives all sins. Allah is the most forgiving. So have that good thought of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is merciful. As the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam mentions a man. A man that was on his deathbed. A man that was on his deathbed. And this man had committed all sorts of sins. In some narration says that this man had committed every single sin you think of. And then when this man was on his deathbed, he knew that his time is coming. He knew that that time is coming where he can't turn back. So he called his children and he said, What kind of a father was I to you? So they said, you are a good father to us. So he said, if I command you to do something, would you listen and obey me? So they said, yes. So he said, when I die, burn me. Burn me, and when I turn into ashes, cast my ashes and divide it on earth and in the sea. When I turn into ashes, put some of my ashes on land and some of it in the sea and the ocean. So they said, oh father, what kind of a thing are you asking for? He said, you obey me and do exactly what I said. So when he died, his children did exactly what their father commanded them to do. So they burnt him. And when he turned into ashes, they put some of the ashes on land, the other part in the ocean, divided them all over the earth. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the one that created them the first time, brought him the second time, and Allah azza wa jalla brought him the way he was. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala asked him, and he said, oh my servant, what made you do what you did? What kind of a crazy thing and act is that? What made you do what you did? So he replies back to Allah and says, ya Allah, I did that because I feared you. Because I was afraid from you, ya Rabb. So Allah Azza wa Jalla said, because you feed me, I forgive you. Because you feed me, I forgive you. Because you feed me and you are afraid from my punishment, I forgive you today and you could enter the paradise. Subhanallah, this is Allah's rahmah, Allah's mercy. As much as we think Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala punishes severely, and Allah Azza wa Jalla has a severe punishment, yes. But Allah's mercy is always greater than that. Allah's rahmah is always above that. So when someone on his deathbed, when you experience that moment which we're all going to experience it, think good of Allah. That, ya Allah, ya Allah, I'm a disgraceful servant, a humble servant, creation of yours, coming to you, ya Rabbil Alameen. I've disobeyed you, yes. I've neglected your commandments, yes. But ya Rabb, what's your rahmah compared to this? Your mercy is above what I've done. Your mercy is above the sins I have committed. Your mercy is above the bad deeds I've fallen into. Your mercy is above every anger and every punishment. Ya Rabb, I ask you to forgive me. Have that good thought in Allah. Have that good thought in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is according to the thought of His servants, as the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said. Also, my brothers, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will judge us over our last actions. Yes, Allah will judge us over the last actions. See how balanced Islam is? There's a law of hope, but there's a law of fear. And this is how it works with Allah. A law of hope in Allah, but at the same time, a law of fear from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Al-raja wal-khawf. As the scholars always say, this is the mu'min, he lives between two wings. A wing of hope and a wing of fear. One of the things that we should always be afraid of, that know that Allah will judge you over the last action that you do. Over the last deed that you fall into. What you end your life with is what you're going to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. In hadith of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, that one of you will be doing the deeds of the people of the paradise. His whole life. His entire life is doing the deeds of the people of the paradise. Until the last moment of his life. Before he meets Allah, he turns around, starts to do the deeds of the people of the hellfire, and dies and ends up in the hellfire with the people of the hellfire. Someone, his entire life, working for the paradise, the last portion of his life, he changes, dies on it, enters the hellfire. Wal'iyadhu billah. On the other hand, someone, as the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, his entire life is doing the deeds of the people of the hellfire. His entire life, corruption, corruption, corruption. Until the last moment before his death, he changes, he repents to Allah, does a good thing, dies, ends up in the paradise. And that's where the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam says, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِخَوَاتِيمِهَا. Allah judges you over your last actions. What you end your life with is what you're going to face Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. So what's your last action now? Can you predict? Can you predict your last action in life? You cannot. That's why be cautious. That's why be cautious, because you can't predict your last action in life. You do not know what you're going to die on. That moment that you think of the haram and you're going to say, you know what? It's only one haram. I'll do it and repent to Allah. That moment you could go and fall into the haram and never come again. That moment that you could say, you know, I could go to this haram place and you know what? I'll repent and Allah will forgive. And yes, Allah will forgive, but what guarantee do you have that your life would not end up in that haram place? And then you'll be resurrected while you were drunk or committing zina or taking drugs. Wal'iyadhu billah. Rather to be resurrected while you're praying or reading the Quran or fasting or calling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or doing something that pleases Allah azza wa jal. So what you end your life with is what you're going to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. And the last actions of your life is what you'll be judged over. That's why when you die on something, you'll be resurrected doing that thing. You'll be resurrected doing that thing. So if you die on the halal path, you'll be resurrected doing the halal. And if you die on the haram path, you'll be resurrected doing the haram. Wal'iyadhu billah. If you die drinking alcohol or in clubs or taking drugs, you'll be resurrected in front of Allah doing that. And then you've got no more excuse. But if you die pleasing Allah, praying to Allah, reading the Quran, or doing that with something that pleases Allah, you'll be resurrected doing that. And what a beautiful thing to stand in front of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with. That's why my brothers and sisters, إِنَّمَا الْأَعْمَالُ بِخَوَاتِيمِهَا. The deeds and your ending in accordance to your last actions. What you do last. Because sometimes the shaitan comes and he says, you know what, mate, do it. Who's going to know? You could repent to Allah. But what guarantee do you have that you could go and come back? What guarantee do you have that you could fall into this and that could be your last moment that you breathe air in this life? And that's the last moment they exist on the surface of this earth, and you'll be resurrected with the action. Al-iyadhu billah. That's why always fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and fear Allah azza wa jal with the last deeds and actions that you do in life. And do not be deceived by the shaitan. I do remind you once again what the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says that all the deeds and all the actions are according to the final deeds that you'll be resurrected with in the hereafter. And he sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, people are asleep when they die. When they die, that's when they wake up. My brothers and sisters, we want to wake up before our death. We want to realize before our death. We want to do something before our death. And this is inshallah what we aim to do from behind these lectures. Not just to entertain ourselves. And not just to say, wallahi, that was a nice lecture. But I want to make a change in my life. I want to realize what a lot of people did not realize until later. I want to wake up before everyone else wakes up. I want to understand before everyone else understands. And inshallah, this is what we intend to do from behind this. I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us from amongst those who listen and hear, act upon with the listen and hear. Subhanak Allahum bihamdik, nashhadu an la ilaha illa ant, nastaghfiruka wa natubu ilaik. We have inshallah 10 to 15 minutes for Isha. If any brothers have a question, please ask, but don't ask me things that's going to come next week.
Next week, inshallah, we're going to start with death. Today is an introduction about death. Okay, what happens, our purpose and so on. Next week, inshallah, we're going to talk about just before what's death. Just before what's death, when someone dies, what happens? And all the way after death, and when the coffin is put into the grave, and the man is put into the grave, and so on. Inshallah, Brother Muhammad. Alaykum as-salam. Now, again, I do mention, so in case you do hear that from other scholars, this is a controversial topic amongst the scholars, where some ahadith indicate that there are people in the hellfire now and there are people in the paradise. There's a lot of ahadith of that. Other ahadith indicate there's none. Like one of them is that the Prophet Muhammad SAW says, I'll be the first one to enter the Jannah. Okay, he'll be the first one to enter the Jannah. What about those prophets and messengers before him? And other ahadith say that the hellfire will be brought in the hereafter. It's got a mouth and that. And then it says, Ya Allah, bring anyone that disobeyed you will come into me and so on. So there are ahadith that indicate that. And there are ahadith that indicate this. Now, where are the prophets and messengers? Isn't it clear from the hadith of the Prophet ﷺ when he went to the Mi'raj? Where did he see them? Who did he see in the first heaven, second heaven, third heaven? He saw them in the heavens. He didn't see them in the paradise. He did not see them in the paradise. So it's clear that the Prophet ﷺ, they're in alam al-barzakh. There in that world between this world and the hereafter. As I mentioned before, we are in a world called Alam al-Dunya. After this world is called Alam al-Barzakh, which is the world where people die before they get resurrected. After Alam al-Barzakh is Alam al-Akhirah, which is the day or the Alam or the world of resurrection. And that's when everyone gets resurrected, including those who die, including those who are dead. So the prophets and messengers are in Alam al-Barzakh. But what's Alam al-Barzakh? Alam al-Barzakh is just the grave. Alam al-Barzakh is not just a grave. Alam al-Barzakh, as the scholars say, and there's some weak narration that narrate that, but there's a lot of other ahadith that speak. It's either a corner of the paradise or a corner of the hellfire. One of the famous ahadith that we'll talk about next week, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the soul goes into the grave, Allah azza wa jal will say to the angels, after Allah is pleased from that soul, if it's a good soul, Allah will say to the angels, let my servant eat from the hellfire, eat from the paradise, drink from the paradise, clothing from the paradise, let him sleep on a bed of the paradise, and let him sleep until the day of resurrection comes. All that still before the paradise. But again, there are some narrations, as the Prophet ﷺ, he says about the shuhada, they like in birds flying under the throne of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and so on. But a lot of the scholars say that these ahadith are referring to later. But whether it's like this or like that, we surrender to it. You know, these information, we have to surrender to them otherwise. Because at the end of the day, that information does not benefit us as practicality in this world. It benefits our iman to believe that it does exist. But we can't do anything. What are you going to do? What actions are you required to do based on it? Now, and I do emphasize on the point that I mentioned before. Okay, the shaitan comes through these chapters or through these lessons. He comes through to you and he says, death. He makes you complicated, confused. Like for example, if I'm going to die, what's the point of me working? Why should I care about my dunya, this? No, live your dunya as you live your dunya. Live your akhirah as you live your akhirah. Live both. Okay? Okay, when it's time for din, it's time for din. And if it's time for the dunya, it's time for the dunya. Okay, because shaitan knows how to come and twist things around. We told you, forget about the dunya, stick to the din, and this and that, and makes you go all the way in the din that you forget later on the din and you're stuck in the dunya. You know, this is how the Nabi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, the one that goes extreme in that path is like the one that's riding a camel or a horse in the middle of the desert. It makes it run so hard that at the end of the day, the horse or the camel will collapse and they end up not reaching his destination. فَإِنَّ الْمُبَتَّ لَا أَرْضًا قَطَعَ وَلَا ظَهْرًا أَبْقَى. And it's a beautiful example. The one that goes extreme in those areas does not leave a mount to ride on and does not even reach his destination. We need to balance. That's why, live your life as you live your life. I've got a career, continue with it and do the best. But I've got deen, I continue with it and I do the best. I balance in between. And that's why, you know, and this didn't happen to us, it even happened with the Sahaba. A group of companions, once Abu Bakr saw Handala, he said, oh Handala, how's your day? You know, how's it going? So Handala said, I feel like a hypocrite. Allahu Akbar. Handala, you? One of the companions who fought with the Prophet ﷺ in Badr, you feel like a munafiq? Abu Bakr said, how could you even say something like this about yourself?
So he said, wallahi, the reason I say that is because when I sit in front of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he talks about the paradise, he talks about the hellfire, it's like I could see it with my own eyes. But once I got mixed with my family, once I got mixed with my kids, once I got mixed with my friends, it's like I had forgotten everything that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said. So Abu Bakr said, wallahi, I experienced what you experience. Abu Bakr, brothers and sisters, Abu Bakr at the end start to say, I feel like a munafiq. Abu Bakr! You know Abu Bakr, and you know who Abu Bakr radiallahu ta'ala anhu is? He said, I feel like a munafiq too. So they ran to the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam, saying to him, O Messenger of Allah, we feel like munafiqeen, we feel like hypocrites. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, why? So they said, O Messenger of Allah, it's because every time we sit in front of you, you talk about the paradise and the hellfire, it's like we could see it with our eyes. Once we get mixed with the family, friends and work, we forget everything. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, by Allah, listen to what he said. He said, by Allah, if you stay in the same state that you are with me after you leave me, if you stay in the same state than when you are with me after you leave me, you would have shook hands with the angels. And that's how high you become. Then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, but the deen, it's time and time. That's what he said. Sa'a wa sa'a, sa'a wa sa'a, sa'a wa sa'a. Time and time, time and time, time and time. This time for you, for Allah, for His Messenger, for His deen. And this time for your family, for your kids, for your work and so on. So give time here and give time there. That you cannot mix the two. This time for this and this time for that. And also you get people reaching to the stage, and this has become, the scholars had spoken about it in the past when you talk about the Mahdi and how the Prophet ﷺ says that, you know, it will be victory and the victory on the hands of Mahdi. A lot of people tell you, what should I do da'wah for? Wait for the Mahdi to come. And this is from the shaitan. Yeah, and a lot of the scholars spoke about this. Why should we strive for this deen? Why should we work hard for this deen? Wait for the Mahdi to come. This is exactly what shaitan wants you to do. He wants you to stop the da'wah for Allah when the Mahdi is going to come, maybe after 10,000 years. Okay, he wants you to stop the da'wah for 10,000 years, so when the Mahdi comes for 100 years, you do the da'wah. This is exactly what the shaitan wants from you. You know, and you read a lot of the scholars, they say in the past, they reached the stage where people just said, you know, we've got no hope in this ummah until the Mahdi comes. Hey, what does it mean? You know what? I'm going to go home and everyone go home. When the Mahdi comes, call me. Hey, look, this is exactly what the shaitan wants you to do. Forget about the da'wah. Say, alhamdulillah, what we're doing right now, till the Mahdi, wait till he comes. No, you know, don't let these things come into you. We have to be balanced. We have to be balanced. Don't let the shaitan play with our emotions. Don't let shaitan play, you know, with the way we think and start taking us thinking that we're going to please Allah when we're not.
Jazakum Allah khair. Subhanakallah bhamdik. Nashadu an la ilaha illa anta wa atubu ilayk.
To listen to or download more Islamic lectures, please visit www.islamicmedia.com.au.